Hello, I am Dr. Kaushik Mukhopadhyay. Today I am going to discuss a very important chapter, opioid analgesics and antagonists. So it will be covered in two sections. Today we will mainly discuss the pain pathway and why the opioid analgesics are the best analgesics available in the market. But still, in common people, opioids are mainly known from its narcotic potential. Let's start with what is pain? Life is painful, right? So pain is an unpleasant sensory and emotional experience associated with actual or potential tissue damage. So it is, from the definition, you can understand that it is not only a sensory thing, also an emotional experience. Many times you will see that a few person who is more vulnerable to the same kind of pain, but other persons are very much relatively tolerant to that. So there is always an emotional experience is attached with the definition of the pain. So the pain perception. So it has one part that is the pain sensation is rising from the nociceptors throughout our body over the skin, and this from this nociceptor the pain fibers are carrying the pain sensation to the brain. But of course there is a very significant role about the perception. So the reticular formation and the basal ganglia or the limbic system, everything is together when we talk about pain. So how we can classify it? We can classify it in many different ways. So first, it may be a somatic pain or visceral pain. So whatever pain that is arising from the skin taken by the nociceptors, we can call it somatic pain. And the visceral pain, it is a very dull aching kind of pain, or it may be colicky pain. So this kind of pain is actually arising from the viscera. Next is severity. By severity, we can classify as mild, moderate, and severe pain. Like cancer pain is known to be severe pain, and fracture, or maybe multiple fractures. The pain associated with multiple bone fractures can be considered a severe pain. Next is duration. Is the pain acute, or is the pain subacute, or it is a chronic pain? So based on different way, you can classify this pain in different manner. So this diagram shows how the pain is carried, the sensation of somatic pain. Now mainly in our discussion, we will talk about somatic pain. So whenever there is injury, there are three nerve endings are there, which is taking the sensation. So if there is injury, there is release of chemical mediators. You know the prostaglandins, the PGs are very important. The prostaglandins and other substances, that is inflammatory mediators, that causes irritation of these nociceptors. It is carried to the dorsal horn of spinal cord. So this is dorsal part and this is ventral, from if you see the sections of spinal cord. From here it synapses, it is a synapse, it comes, it ends here, and the second daughter neuron, so this is the second daughter neuron, it crosses the sign and then it starts going up. So this tract, it is called spinothalamic tract. Spinothalamic tract. This tract carries most of the pain sensation. There is another tract called spinocerebellar tract also, so this is also there. But the main part is the spinothalamic tract. It goes up and sometimes it forms, it gives some input to the medulla and midbrain also, but actually it terminates in the thalamus. From the thalamus, it goes to the next part, that is the sensory, somatosensory system. So we have this sensory homunculus. I think you remember from your physiology. You can remember from your physiology classes that our brain has a very beautiful mapping of everything that is inside our body. So this pain, suppose it is arising from the leg. If it is arising from the leg, then termination of second order neuron, the third order neuron, so here comes the third order neuron, it will carry sensation to this part, so this foot and leg, so this part. So from there, brain can localize from where the pain is arising, and accordingly it can take actions like motor manifestation. So if it is a cut injury over your leg, you will quickly remove your leg from some disturbing element. So this is how the brain, the pain actually goes from sensory system, from the periphery to the cerebral cortex. And if you see that how the pain is managed, so this is we can call ascending pathway of pain. And there is another thing called descending pathway also. And this is related to gating of pain, also called gating of pain. So it starts from the midbrain. So you can see so this is actually same picture, but only it is sagittal section. So you can see here is our midbrain part. From here the section has been cut, and you can see it here. From here the section has been cut here, and you can see it here, and this is the spinal cord, you can understand. So we have this periaqueductal gray in our midbrain, periaqueductal gray. It sends a set of neurons which goes to medulla, and it forms in the nucleus raphe magnus. From this nucleus raphe magnus, there is another descending pathway. It goes towards the spinal cord. And this is a serotonergic 5-HT or norepinephrine. These neurons, what they do, they ends here, and this is one set of neuron which is an encephalin neuron. So these neurons secrete opioid. So what is opioid? Endogenous opioids. What is opioid? I am coming to the next slide, but for this slide you just understand the gating of pain. So as soon as it has a negative impact on this, so this transmission that was going on from the first order to the second order, this is inhibited by this system. So this system starts with periaqueductal gray, then in the next step it activates nucleus raphe magnus. From the nucleus raphe magnus it goes to the spinal cord, different levels of spinal cord, and there is one encephalin neuron which ultimately gets activated, and it has negative impact on the pain pathway. So ultimately when this pathway is activated, this pathway is inhibited. So ultimately the pain sensation will not go up, and we have a relief of pain. So this is body's own analgesia. Okay, so this is called gating of pain or descending pathway of pain. Now this all has been discussed in physiology, but still before understanding opioid, this knowledge will be required to understand how, when we give exogenous opioid like morphine, how it acts on different level of our the pain pathway. Okay, enough of the review. Now we go to actually how we can actually to the relatively pharmacology part. So how we can inhibit the pain pathway. So what we can do, so we can do it in different level or different approaches. So how to decrease pain? First approach may be the inhibition of prostaglandins. So this may be the first approach, inhibition of prostaglandins, and we can give cyclooxygen as inhibitor, or we can call it NSAIDs. So you know the NSAIDs we have already covered, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs that will decrease the inflammation, that will decrease the inflammation, decrease the prostaglandin generation. So ultimately the pain will decrease. Secondly, we can give local anesthetic like lignocaine. But the problem with local anesthetic then is that it is only temporary. So only during surgical procedure we can use. Otherwise, it is not for long-term effect. But yes, of course, during the surgical procedure, we can use this local anesthetic to decrease the pain. So this is number one. This is number two mechanism, how we can decrease the pain. Number three, we can give opioid. That is the main part of today's discussion, the opioid. How it does that, I will gradually tell you. These opioids actually act on different level. It acts on the spinal level, it acts on supraspinal level also. So you can see here also, the opioid is here. The fourth strategy may be antidepressant. How antidepressants act? I have already give you the lectures of antidepressant drugs. And I think you remember that antidepressants have this especially they are effective in neuropathic pain. And what they do, they modulate the norepinephrine and serotonin level inside the brain. And ultimately, it decreases the pain perception of the brain, and it alters the mood also. So pain is also related to the mood and affects it, as it is related to limbic system. So that part is taken care of by antidepressants. So perception of pain, in the first slide you show that there is one stimulus part and another was the perception part. So the perception part is taken care by antidepressant and to some extent opioids also. And if nothing can control it, we have these general anesthetics that can be given in extreme conditions. Okay, otherwise as an analgesic it is not a classical analgesic, but of course analgesia during surgery, this general anesthetics have a very important roles to play. we can call it five. So you can see there are five strategies how we can tackle pain. First is NSAIDs, second is local anesthesia, third opioid, fourth antidepressant, and fifth is general anesthesia. Among them, this anesthesia is only for temporary part, or temporary time during surgery, this kind of thing. But mainly, if you see that if you are going to treat a patient clinically and you are going to use it for long term, then we have only three approaches. This is the NSAID, opioid, and antidepressant. Now we are moving to the actual class today, that is opioid. But before going to actual opioid term, let me tell you about a few things that is very close to each other, a few terminologies, but you must remember the differences between them. So first, what is opium? The first term you have to remember is the opium. It is a dark brown resin kind of material, and this is available from this plant, Papaver somniferum. So it is known for centuries that this Papaver somniferum can decrease pain. In old time in China, in India also, this we call poppy seeds. The poppy seeds were known to decrease pain, but they, of course, they did not know that what are the compounds and what is the details. But they know that these poppy seeds are a very good analgesics, and till now we have not found any better analgesic than this opium. Okay, so you can see that there is a long history. So this is the poppy seeds. You can see the poppy, Papaver somniferum. This is the tree, and opium is the resinous material. So you can think about it is a resinous material synthesized. It is a dark brown color, and it is obtained from this poppy seeds or this Papaver somniferum. Next term is opiates. What is opiates? Opiates are those alkaloids which are available from this opium. So these are alkaloids, opiates. Now all the opiates are not analgesic. So you can classify it as analgesic, with analgesic property, and without analgesic property. Without analgesic. This is the two way we can classify. From this analgesic, the most important drug is morphine. So the name has come from a Greek god of dream, Morpheus. So the alkaloid is called morphine also, and it is abundant in opium. To some extent we get this another alkaloid called codeine, and there is another called thibane also. I am not writing this. There is some alkaloid which is available from this opium, but they are not analgesic, they do not have analgesic property, are papaverine. And there is another noscapine, but you remember this because this is used in erectile dysfunction. This has separate use. It is not analgesic, but it has its own use. So these are opioids. What is opioids? Opioids are those analgesics which have property like morphine, but they are not synthesized from opium. So opiates, it may be analgesic, may not be analgesic, but it is available from opium. What is opium? Opium is a resinous material available from Papaver somniferum. What is opioid? Opioid is an analgesic, but it is not available from opium, but has pharmacological property of this morphine. So these are called opioids. And the fourth term is this endogenous opioids. So inside our body, we have receptors, like you can see that mu opioid receptor, kappa opioid receptor, delta opioid receptor, all these receptors are inside the body. But of course, the nature has not given something to the body which does not have any endogenous neurotransmitter, right? So we have opioids inside our body also. So these are called endogenous opioids. Okay, what are those? These are list of these opioids: endorphins, enkephalins, and dynorphins. So these are three group of opioids which are important in case of, if you think about endogenous opioids. And these are the receptors of endogenous opioids: mu, delta, and kappa. Also, it is called MOR, that is mu opioid receptor, DOR, and COR. So kappa opioid receptor, that is the full form. And you can see it is a table taken from Katzan. So you see that we have these different endorphins, we have these different endogenous opioids, but thus this selectivity is different in case of a different receptor. Like endorphins have higher selectivity to mu, whereas enkephalins have higher selectivity to delta, and dynorphins have higher selectivity to kappa. And what are the functions of each receptor that has been given in this table? So you can see this analgesia, the supraspinal and spinal analgesia. What are those? I am coming later. Supraspinal and spinal analgesia. This is a common property of all this receptor, all the opioid receptors. So that is why opioid is a very beautiful analgesic. Every kind of opioid receptor has analgesic property. But there are some other features also that is shown, like sedation, inhibition of respiration, slowed gastrointestinal tract, modulation of hormone, neurotransmitter release. These are all done by MR. MR is the predominant opioid receptor that is present inside our body, and this endorphins are the predominant alkaloid, that is opioid, that is inside our body. The mood effect, the psychomimetic effect here, it is controlled by kappa opioid receptor. Whereas modulation of hormone and neurotransmitter release along with MOR also DOR also does that. So this is a very brief description of different kind of opioid receptor and what are their functions and what kind of endogenous opioids binds with that. Morphine and codeine, as already discussed, they are available from natural opium. Next we have second group, that semi-synthetic opiates. Ultimately one part should be from opium, so that is why it is called semi-synthetic opiates. And when that is become synthetic, you see that it becomes opioids. So this thing we already discussed. So from the semi-synthetic opiates, you see this is a major compound, diacetyl morphine, also known as very popular heroin. So don't confuse the words with this heroin term, which basically means actress or lead actress, you can say. So this just be careful about the spelling itself. Other drugs from the semi-synthetic opioids are oxycodone. These two at least you remember. Next is synthetic opioids: pethidine, fentanyl, sufentanyl, ramifentanyl, methadone and tramadol. Everything written in yellow in this line, that is clinically important. May it be drugs for addiction, or maybe a drug for analgesia. This fentanyl, sufentanyl, these drugs are used along with anesthesia. Tramadol is a drug which is an opioid, but this is not restricted. It is not a restricted drug. So these are the differences are there in different drugs based on their sources. So you can think, we already discussed this, the three kind of receptor, mu, delta and kappa. Let's see how this mu opioid receptor actually works. So this is a synapse that is present in the substantia gelatinosa, that is dorsal horn of spinal cord, dorsal horn. So if you see in this diagram, it is situated here. Now we're focusing in that area in this next slide. So pain stimulation is coming from outside, from nociceptors. This is coming, and here in the this synapse is inside the spinal cord, as you know, especially the substantia gelatinosa, the dorsal of spinal cord. So this first order neuron, and this is the second order neuron. What is usually happens that there are two kind of molecules are there which transmit this. So we have glutamate and we have neuropeptide like substance P. So either it is mainly done by neuropeptide, the chronic pain is mainly transmitted by this neuropeptide, that is substance P. But the fast pain is transmitted by glutamate. You know there are two kinds of fiber that are there, A delta and C fiber. A delta are myelinated, this is again knowledge from physiology, and C fibers are non-myelinated. There are two kinds of fibers that carry pain. The very sharp and localized pain carried by this first myelinated fibers, A delta. And a slow burning like pain that is Darlington pain, that is carried by type C. And they have different neurotransmitters also, mainly the A-delta, the glutamate, the AMPA and NMD receptors. These are mainly important. For C fibers, the substance P is mainly important. But of course, there are some overlaps. What mu receptor does, so you can see mu opioid receptor are present in the presynaptic membrane as well as postsynaptic membrane. In presynaptic membrane, it inhibits the calcium entry. So you know, for any kind of neurotransmitter release, we require entry of calcium inside the cell, which will cause fusion of vesicle, and ultimately the neurotransmitter will be released, and that can act on different part of the synapse. So this calcium entry is inhibited by mu opioid receptor, number one. Number two, this mu opioid receptor makes, so it activates the potassium channel. It increases the activity of potassium channel. So this membrane becomes hyperpolarized. So hyperpolarization occurs. So this is number two mechanism. And everything is happening where? At the spinal level. So I already introduced the term spinal analgesia and supraspinal. So this is happening at the spinal level. It decreases calcium entry and it also increases potassium exit in the postsynaptic membrane, making the membrane hyperpolarized. So taken together, mu opioid receptor inhibits transmission from 1 to 2. It inhibits this transmission. So this is the mechanism at the spinal level. So you can see the molecular mechanism, different way how these different receptors can work. There are three kinds of receptor: mu opioid receptor, delta and kappa. Mu opioid receptor can act by this mechanism, by you can see here, really decreased release of neurotransmitter by decreased calcium channel activity and also by increasing potassium conductance. And it can also decrease the activity of adenine cyclase so that cellular cyclic AMP level decreases. Whereas kappa opioid receptor has a unique feature of only calcium channel. So it does not have any potassium channel activity, okay, the kappa opioid receptor. But agonist, again, all of them, agonists are those, the beta endorphins, enkephalins and dynorphins. So you can see here, dynorphins are the main agonist in the kappa. Beta endorphins are activate morphine as well as mu and as well as delta. Whereas enkephalin is mainly for delta. So these things you try to remember. If you forget this thing, do not forget that how mu opioid receptor. So overall, if you see that mainly the membrane hyperpolarization, decreased release of neurotransmitter, mainly its action is inhibitory. Overall, the mu opioid receptor is inhibitory. Again, I am coming back to this diagram here, getting a pain. So now, if you see the question, why morphine is the most potent analgesic available, most efficacious also. So it is most efficacious rather. Why it is the best analgesic available? First is that it has some action in the peripheral level also, although it is not very clear how it acts, but it is postulated that the nociceptive pain arising from the stimulation of the peripheral nerve receptors here, in the periphery, it has some action in the peripheral nerve receptors or nociceptors. So this is number one. Number two, here it has spinal analgesia. How? I already discussed here. So this is the mechanism of spinal analgesia by mu opioid receptor. Okay, so this is the second layer. Third layer is that it also increases activity, it has increased activity in periaqueductal gray. So in the midbrain we have this periaqueductal gray, which increases the secretion of this norepinephrine and serotonin pathway. You remember from this, again I'm going back to that diagram again. Here I already discussed this periaqueductal gray, it increases activity of this serotonergic neuron system, which inhibits the transmission from 1 to 2. This neuron, you can see there is an interneuron. This interneuron, it activates this interneuron, which releases this endorphins here. And these endorphins acts by this mechanism. So you see that there is, where this, the, here is a mu opioid receptor, you can see. So this endorphins, so the endorphins will bind to this mu opioid receptor as well as this mu opioid receptor. Where from these endorphins are coming? This is coming from another set of neurons. This neuron is activated by this 5-HT or norepinephrine. So this neuron is shown here. Here in this red, you can see here. So let me clear a bit. It is here. Here is this interneuron which releases endorphins in the synapse and it inhibits the transmission from 1 to 2. Okay, I think now it is clear that what is the spinal level. Now moving, going back to the supraspinal level, how morphine acts in the supraspinal level. There is a neuron, you can see here. Here you concentrate. This is actually this place. This is actually this place, okay. So you can, we can see like this. So this is magnified here. What happens that this serotonergic, it is going to nucleus raphe magnus. This neuron is under inhibitory control of a GABA neuron. It is a GABAergic neuron which is technically active. So always this GABAergic neuron is active. If GABAergic neuron is active, this neuron is inhibited. So this pathway is getting inhibited. So if this pathway is getting inhibited, then it cannot fire this norepinephrine serotonergic system. So ultimately, there is no gating of pain. So in normal condition, the pain transmission pathway is on. The gate is not closed. The gate is open. So it can easily transfer here to here. But what happens if there is endorphins available in the periaqueductal gate? This mu opioid receptor, you know that always mu opioid receptor are inhibitory. So it inhibits release of this GABAergic neuron. So this inhibition is now gone. So we can think that it becomes positive. So if this input from periaqueductal gray to medulla, that is from pons to medulla, if this negative becomes positive, then in the next step, this step is also gets positive. And finally, there is getting of pain. So ultimately here it is inhibited. Okay. So you can see this mu opioid receptor activation in the periaqueductal gray leads to increased inhibition in the spinal level. So this is called supraspinal. In this diagram, you will also see. Let me clear this everything. So here this is seen. So PAG, it activates this nucleus raphe magnus, which activates in the spinal level. This PAG activation is under control by a GABA neuron, which is tonically active. This GABA is inhibited by mu opioid receptor. So ultimately PAG can get activated. If PAG activation done, then nucleus raphe magnus increased firing. So this 5-HT or norepinephrine neurons can inhibit this pathway. Okay, so this is spinal level. So you can see we have effect of morphine first in the periphery, which is relatively questionable, but yes, the effect is there. Second, in the spinal level. Third, at the supraspinal level, that is pons and medulla level, mainly midbrain level. So these three layers of inhibition of pain can be achieved by morphine. Okay, that is why it is the best analgesic. There is an additional action also. So you can see one input is going from periaqueductal gray to locus ceruleus, which is again going to the higher center. So everything, this pathway is related to the pain perception. So perception of pain is also altered by morphine. So not only the actual stimulus, pain stimulus is coming at low level from the spinous level. This interpretation or processing of pain is also inhibited by morphine. So it has, so patient is having pain, but the person becomes relatively tolerant to pain. He does not feel that pain at that much. The pain is coming, but he is just a bit detached to that pain. There is a sense of detachment. So this mechanism is also adding to its analgesic action. So I think now you understand why morphine is the best analgesic available. Next, we move on to the other pharmacological action in other parts of nervous system. Analgesia, we have already covered. We have the spinal analgesia, spinal level, supraspinal level, and periphery level. So, I've already discussed this. Next is sedation. It has, actually, drowsiness can cause at low concentration. In increased concentration of morphine, it promotes sleep. And if it is more than that, it can cause coma also. So, it has sedatory effect. But it does not have any anticonvulsant effect. So this you have to remember. Actually, it is increases seizure activity. It increases seizure activity. So it promotes sedation. But the sedation promotion is not like hypnotic drugs, which has anticonvulsant action. It is not like that. It is absolutely different. It has some sedatory effect, but it increases seizure activity. So you cannot use it for as anticonvulsant. Next, mood and subjective effects. Now, the effect of morphine on mood is relatively complex. So if a person takes morphine, it is not very much euphoric, but if a patient is having some pain, it actually elevates mood. I should not say elevate mood, it makes a detachment of pain, as I already told. And if your individual can find this feeling a pleasurable. So one thing you can understand that the subjective or mood effects of morphine, it is not very pleasurable for everyone. But if your individual gets addicted to the feelings of this, the sense of detachment, limbs may feel heavy, but there is mental clouding. So this kind of thing may be pleasurable to some individual. So for those individuals, they get addicted to that. Next on respiratory center, it inhibits respiratory, it depresses respiratory center. There is very important clinical phenomena why you have to remember this, that if a patient is suffering from any respiratory distress and if there is a head injury, you should not use morphine. Why you should not use morphine? First, it depresses respiratory center, that is one condition, one thing. Second, also it causes vasodilation. I will discuss the effect of morphine in the cardiovascular system just after this slide. So it causes vasodilation, which causes cerebral vasodilation also. So if a patient is having intracranial bleeding, that can be aggravated. The pressure effect of this hemorrhage can be aggravated. So it is absolutely contraindicated in head injury. I will of course discuss when I discuss the contraindication of morphine in the next class. But still, as this point has come, I mention this. Cough center, it decreases. Chemoreceptor trigger zone, it stimulates. So it can cause nausea and vomiting. Edinger Westphal nucleus, it has effect of the, it can cause meiosis. So the effect is due to the stimulation of Edinger Westphal nucleus. Now you can ask that, sir, you just told that it actually always inhibitory. So how it stimulates? It stimulates by decreasing the activity of tonically active GABA neurons, just like in the spinal area also, just like the periaqueductal gray also. So tonically active, just in EW nucleus, there is a GABAergic neuron which tonically depresses Edinger Westphal nucleus. The morphine removes this GABAergic tonical activity. So ultimately, there is stimulation of Edinger Westphal nucleus. So what we get from here is meiosis. Meiosis. Vagal center, it increases activity of vagal center and decreases activity of vasomotor center. So these are the effect on different nervous system parts. Next, we move on to the neuroendocrine. So here, in a nutshell, the other effects of morphine has been described. So you can see the vagal center, the in the left, you have stimulant effects on vagal center, on CTJ, on Edinger Westphal nucleus. These are all activated, increased activity. And the antinociceptive system, that is the pain pathway, descending pain pathway, it also activates that. We already discussed in detail. The analgesia is related to that. Or you should say supraspinal analgesia. Supraspinal analgesia. So all of these systems are stimulated. Smooth muscle contracture is increased. So bowel, there may be spastic. This activity, so it can cause constipation. So it is written here. As it can increase the activity of the sphincters, it can cause constipation. It decreases propulsive movements. It decreases propulsive movements and increase propulsive movements and increase sphincter activity. And it decreases all secretions also. So if you see, taken together, the constipation and decreased secretions, they can be used as antidiarrheal. For anti-nociceptive system, it can be used as analgesic. In ureter, bladder, or bladder sphincter, they have all stimulatory effect. Okay. It is given under stimulation. Then dampening effect. Decreased pain sensation, so you can use it for analgesic. Decreased mood and alertness. Decreased cups, respiratory center, depressed cup center. And I told you that the CTJ is activated by morphine, so it increases vomiting. But on high dose, it actually depresses emetic center. But it is not used as anti-emetic because it is in a very high dose. So in low dose, it can cause nausea and vomiting. In high dose, it depresses emetic center, but still it is not a drug that can be used as anti-emetic. So except these things that is mentioned here, we also need to know about the effect on neuroendocrine. Under neuroendocrine, it decreases activity of FSH, LH, ACTH, these hormones. But increases activity of, so I can giving as a stimulation, with the stimulation part I am writing. It increases prolactin level and GH. Actually, it decreases action of the hypothalamus control over the pituitary. So if the control, this FSH, LH, ACTH, these are all required, these are all secreted with the positive stimulus from hypothalamus. Whereas prolactin, GH, these are under negative control of hypothalamus. So if the control of hypothalamus is removed, the action of prolactin or GH is increased, but FSH, LH, ACTH activity is decreased. So this is all about neuroendocrine. Next, CVS. Very important CVS action, action of morphine on CVS. Morphine causes vasodilation. So it causes decreased BP by vasodilation. It causes vasodilation by histamine release. It increases histamine release. That may be a problem for bronchial asthma patient. Second, it decreases vasomotor center. So it also leads to vasodilation. And finally, it has some direct vasodilatory effect. So direct vasodilatory effect is there. Direct vasodilation. So all of them taken together, if you give morphine, suddenly blood pressure can drop, especially intravenous. And the vasodilation is more in systemic circulation than pulmonary circulation. So if you use it in pulmonary edema, the blood will shift. It is caused mainly systemic vasodilation. So blood will shift from pulmonary circulation to systemic circulation. And that can actually help in pulmonary edema. But it does not have a direct effect on heart rate. But of course, as you know, in the last slide, you have seen that it has increased vagal effect. So there may be chances of bradycardia. So in myocardial infarction, you know that we use morphine first to decrease apprehension. And second, there are some vasodilatory effects also. But mainly the apprehension is the main reason why we use morphine in this acute myocardial infarction. So when we discuss use, I will discuss this in detail. So now pharmacokinetics. Okay, let's we end this session here. From the next day, we will discuss the pharmacokinetics of morphine, use of morphine, contraindication of morphine, and other morphine-like agents. So this is all for today. What we learned? We learned the pain pathway, the difference between opium, opioid, and endogenous opioid, how morphine acts at different levels. Mostly this slide is the main slide of this class, the mechanism of action of morphine. Then we discuss some pharmacological actions of morphine, and on the next day we will continue our discussion on the pharmacokinetics, use, contraindication of morphine, and other opioid agonists we will discuss. Okay, thank you for listening. Stay healthy. Goodbye.